Is that?
No.
Okay. Okay. Hey, how you doing? Different venue. Number one, let me thank you all for being here, and look how quickly things can change in 24 hours. And yesterday, I was with Judge Alina Hidalgo at Transtar, and we were talking about the seriousness of this storm, and it is still a very serious storm, and the concern that Houston could be a direct hit from Hurricane Laura. And in 24 hours, it seems as though the storm has moved slightly to the right. At least it does not appear that Houston would get a direct hit. Nonetheless, this storm has gone from being a tropical storm to a Category 1, now to a Category 4, a very serious storm, which reflects what we have seen over the last several years, and that is we're facing more storms more frequently with greater intensity. And one thing that I do want to underscore is the rapid intensification of these storms. In less than 24 hours, these storms, once they get into the Gulf, into these warm, hot waters, literally can go from a Category 1 to a Category 4, which makes it more difficult to engage in storm mitigation planning, and certainly makes it even more difficult to evacuate, especially a large region like the Houston-Harris County region. Nonetheless, we had really ramped up and was prepared for the worst, hoping for the best, and I will tell you, until this storm clears and is out of here, we'll continue to be ready and prepared for anything that may come Houston's way. And so I'm proud to be here with the Mayor Pro Tem, Martin, Councilmember Abby Kamen, Councilwoman Sheila Jackson Lee is here, and with the rest of Houston's team. So I want to kind of just go through quickly a few things. I still want people to be on their guard. We are cautiously optimistic, but until the storm has left, I don't want anyone to let their guards down. We are still asking people to be off the roads this evening at about 8 p.m. To be off the roads. And then because of the magnitude of this storm and the intensity of this storm, you know, there will still be wind and there will still be rain. And so again, for people's safety and the safety of our first responders, because they will still be out there, I'm asking people to simply to work with all of us and to be off the road by 8 p.m. Now, there are a number of things that we are already doing to get prepared for this storm, and even then, we'll continue to be prepared. And as you know, if you can remember from Hurricane Ike in 2008, the power went out for about 14 days, and the heat and the trees went down. And so we were anticipating, because this was more going to be more of a wind event than a rain event, that we were going to be facing power outages. And I had my conversations, for example, with the CEO of CenterPoint on yesterday, along with his team, about making sure that we had ample resources available. The 2,000 employees that are right here in with CenterPoint here in Houston, and another up to about 7,000. And so Elizabeth Brock is here with CenterPoint. Since we still may be facing wind and outages and trees being down, Elizabeth, why don't you just come and tell us where the preparation that CenterPoint had already made to put us in the best position.
Thank you, Mayor. CenterPoint Energy, good afternoon. CenterPoint Energy has been preparing for Hurricane Laura since last week. We have a highly skilled workforce that have been working very closely, monitoring the storm, and ready to begin restoration wherever the storm lands. We definitely have been preparing for the worst. We have 30 staging sites ready to respond. We have more than 6,500 resources ready to restore service when it is safe to do so. That number includes 2,400 of CenterPoint resources and more than 4,100 mutual assistance resources. The company's first priority is safety, which means we will address down power lines and restore service to key facilities such as hospitals, water treatment plants, public service facilities such as fire and police stations. Then the company will focus its repairs on major lines that will restore power to the greatest number of customers in the shortest amount of time. We will work until everyone's power is restored, and then we will turn our focus on helping our neighbors. I'd like to review a few items to note. If you have been designated a critical care customer or need to be designated, please make sure you contact your electric provider. Please remember that even if you are registered as a critical care customer, that does not mean you will not lose power. You should always have a backup plan. For questions and outages, please visit CenterPoint Outage Tracker. Please log on to our website, CenterPointEnergy/StormCenter, for electric and gas safety tips. The company's smart meters will automatically notify us when your power is out, so you do not need to call us for power outages. However, if you have a safety concern, please call CenterPoint at 713-207-2222 or dial 911. Thank you, and please be safe.
I want to emphasize the importance we are still in hurricane season. Regardless of what happens with Hurricane Laura, we remain in hurricane season until sometime in November. And so for our seniors and those who are on oxygen, please sign up with CenterPoint for the critical care program. That's very, very important. Now, we are still making preparations, for example, to transition people who are homeless off of our streets and to put them in a better position in shelters. That will continue, regardless of the status of Hurricane Laura. That will continue today. Mark Eichenbach.
Thank you, Mayor. Currently, we have 12 outreach teams that have been operating and are on current standby. Several of those teams are working right now, focusing on the areas of the town that are most at risk for the storm. According to the Office of Emergency Management, we are focusing right now on the 45 corridor between 610 and Clear Lake, working with the Harris County Sheriff's Homeless Outreach Team. We've been spending all week evacuating people on the I-10 East Corridor, and those are the areas of town that are supposed to get the most wind, and that's where we're focusing on offering refuge to unsheltered homeless individuals. Additionally, homeless individuals with cell phones, which actually a lot of homeless individuals do have mobile phones, they are encouraged to contact 311 if they do need shelter. Additionally, HBD patrol units, as well as the differential response team, as well as the HBD homeless outreach team, are also out offering shelter to any homeless individuals that they encounter. We are hoping for the best, but we're also preparing for the worst. And during these COVID times, it is trying. We really appreciate the assistance of the county, the city, and Metro, and all of our homeless agencies and the Coalition for the Homeless that is part of the Way Home Initiative. Thank you.
Thank you. OEM Chief Bunick is coordinating, and OEM is coordinating all of these efforts, making sure that we were prepared for this and will continue to be prepared for not only this storm, but for the others that are coming. Chief Bunick.
Great. Thank you, Mayor, for your leadership during this planning in response to Hurricane Laura. And Congresswoman, thank you for your support and being here with us today in literally the midst of the hurricane. I also want to thank and acknowledge all of our partners up here, and most of them the mayor are introducing that are going to be speaking today, because this is truly a team effort with all city departments coming together, preparing, planning, and then responding. I'd also like to acknowledge and thank Nakia Bradley, who's the Deputy Director of the Office of Emergency Management. She's been working really hard, Mayor, and doing a great job. There's some other folks that aren't here that I also want to acknowledge. The Red Cross has been doing a great job, and certainly CenterPoint Energy, we're glad that they're up here with us. The Office of Emergency Management was activated at 6 o'clock this morning, and we're going to continue our activation until the city's no longer in danger. And what we're doing up there is not only coordinating all the city departments and entities, both public and private sector partners, but we're also monitoring the track of the storm. We're looking at the wind speeds. We're going to look at the rainfall amounts. And then also, since we have Center Point up there, we're going to be looking at all the outages in order to get the proper resources to wherever we meet. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. And of course, our first responders are out 24/7 at all times. Chief Acevedo, HPD.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Mayor. Thank you for leadership and guidance. The department staff has been adjusted as of 3 p.m. today to ensure that we have plenty of HPD uniformed members ready to respond to any eventuality across the city. We've actually had every single member of the department that is on duty report in uniform and ready to respond to calls for a service. The Special Operations Division has pre-staged 20 high water rescue trucks across Houston ready to respond to high water calls. Tactical Operations Division has 9 boats with 20 technical swift water rescue trained personnel who can respond to rescue operations that are out and deployed already, Mayor. Our DOC, the Department Operations Center, has been active since 1 p.m. today, yesterday, and is quickly responding to any needs for resources, to move resources around. We also have deployed our officers and traffic mobility officers and traffic enforcement division throughout the city monitoring locations which traditionally flood, and we will be putting up barricades. If you see barricades, do not be that person that decides to drive through them because they think they can get through. Turn around, don't drown. We said it before, we'll say it again. It is not a slogan, it's a way to stay alive. If you drive through them, not only are you breaking the law, but you're putting yourself at risk. We are ready to assist with any type of high-level evacuations across the city, anywhere in the city, Mayor, and we also have our Fusion Center that will be monitoring social media platforms to looking for people that may not be able to get through our 911 or any 911 system across the affected area here in the Gulf Coast. We'll also be providing assistance at shelters and security shelters and any other evacuation location. And I'm like Mark said, we do have our outreach teams that are out and about checking in with our homeless population, offering to get them to shelter. The last thing we want to say is that we will not tolerate if for some reason, I think, Mayor, you nailed it, these storms are unpredictable. Last year, we thought that Imelda wasn't going to hit us, and then Sam and I remember when we got that, we called each other, and when we talked to you, we stayed heavily deployed, and thank God we did, because the prediction ended up, Mother Nature had different ideas, and we ended up with getting hit hard by Imelda, so we're ready, and please don't put your guard down, because this thing could turn at the last second and impact us significantly. So we're ready, Mayor, and there are no calls pending in terms of zero priority, what we call the code 3 response calls or code 1 response calls, lights and signs, and we're ready to roll.
Right, and I want to underscore the unpredictability or the spinoff from these storms, so we need to be very much ready. Chief Pena with fire.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you for your leadership. Good to see you, Congresswoman. So here we are again. We're in preparation for another storm that's going to hit our general area. I want to assure our community that regardless of the shifting forecasts or projections, that hasn't changed our requirement to continue planning and preparing for the expected weather that's coming in. And we're asking Houstonians to do exactly the same, as the mayor mentioned. Ask you that you review your evacuation plan one more time. Take another peek at your emergency kit to make sure you have all the required items in that kit. Keep your gas tank full. Monitor your local sources for recommendations and information. It's critically important that you stay abreast of all the information. So during the pandemic, your house was probably the safest place to be. That hasn't changed here. We encourage our community to shelter in place, but be vigilant for any changing conditions. And if you're asked to evacuate, please do so promptly. Don't let the Corona 19 or the COVID-19 issues prevent you from promptly heeding those evacuation warnings if they do come. The most important thing is to stay out of harm's way. So we are monitoring this storm closely. We encourage you all to do the same. Log on to HoustonEmergency.org. There you can have recommendations for preparation and updates on what the storm is doing and what the local officials are recommending. Also, sign up for Alert Houston. There you can receive alerts and information as well. So, preparations for the fire department. Once again, our first responders, police officers, firefighters, are going the extra mile to ensure that we're prepared and we're providing the necessary protection for this community. We are issuing PPE to be able to function in this COVID-19 environment. Supplies and equipment have been deployed to the fire stations. And as far as personnel, we are prepared to scale up as needed, but we are staffing up our Marine groups, our special operations groups, Marine groups, hazmat team. We do have 5 SAW teams that are available to deploy throughout the city. We have, again, our rescue team, and we're also going to be in support of the shelters as they come up, Mayor. So, and tomorrow, depending on what the impact of the storm is here in the city of Houston, we'll be prepared to pivot for assessments and provide surveys for any damage that the city may have incurred. We're primarily expecting a wind event. With that, we're expecting some downed power lines, maybe some loss of power. Again, we need to be prepared for those items. If you're going to use generators, be cautious and follow the safety instructions on those generators to the letter. Okay? Those generators should not be used inside your home. Matter of fact, they should be at least 20 feet from your home to be used safely. Use flashlights and battery-operated lights instead of candles. Again, candles are very dangerous if they're left unattended. Stay away from flooded roadways if we get heavy rains in certain areas. As little as 18 inches is enough to float your car away. And again, we've lost too many people because people are trying to drive through across flooded roadways. Be mindful of downed trees and power lines. Again, be cautious about your surroundings. Treat all intersections. If we lose power, any intersection that loses power, treat that as a four-way stop, please. Vehicle accidents, and depending on what the road conditions are, any debris on the road, it may take us a little longer to get to those emergencies. So we ask you to be cautious about that. And in terms of preparation, again, you should have done that already. We recommend 1 gallon of water per person per day and have non-perishable food available as well. That's my report.
Thanks, Chief. Carol Haddock, Director of Public Works.
Thank you, Mayor. Houston Public Works, the 4,000 men and women of the department stand ready to support the city through this. We have converted 18 of our dump trucks to be ready for high water rescue. We've actually staged 10 of them with local fire stations. We're embedded there as we go. We've also put our skeleton crews out at our water and wastewater treatment plants. We actually have to make sure that those both function throughout the storm, topped off our chemicals, made sure that our energy backup supply is ready to go, that Center Point is ready to go should we have any impacts to the energy supply to those, and have all those lined out. We are ready to pivot, just as Chief Pena said with the fire department. We're ready to pivot as soon as this storm goes through. We do expect to see downed trees. We do expect to see traffic signals that have been impacted. If you've got a downed tree, please dial 311, and we will work with fire, parks, solid waste, and public works to get crews out to each of those that are called in. Also, if we have trees that come down, they can often take water lines out that are in your neighborhood. So if a tree falling down pulls up a water line, please call in that water leak as well so that we can get crews out to repair that. This storm, we did not deploy barricades at all the intersections like we normally do because it's primarily a wind event. We do have barricades in trailers that are staged throughout the city such that after the winds die down, if we need to block intersections, we can. But please do not drive into water. Turn around, do not drown. Our signal crews will be out to evaluate the areas where we have signals that are either not have power or damaged as part of the storm, and we will get those back up as soon as possible, but please treat those as a four-way stop. We also have our building inspectors on call as soon as it is safe. If we have structures that are impacted, we'll be out to inspect the structural integrity of those and make sure before anybody re-enters the structure. And lastly, we have secured all of our construction sites to make sure there's no loose debris or anything that could impact as a projectile or the stormwater system. And we encourage everybody to make sure that you have done that both around your house and other construction around the city. Make sure that's happening as well. Thank you very much.
General, there have been some questions in reference to the status at the Houston Airport. So Frank C. Accio. Frank, did I get your last name right?
That's close enough, Mayor.
Okay, it's Frank.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So on behalf of the Houston Airports, currently right now, the Houston Airports are open and functioning. However, there are flights out of both airports, out of William P. Hobby and George Bush Intercontinental Airport, are either suspended or canceled, depending upon the carrier. Based with discussions with the carriers, we're going to cancel everything through Thursday, and we'll reevaluate it by then. The carriers will look to see if it's safe to fly in, and we're looking at anytime after noon on Thursday, operations will continue. We're asking that passengers please contact their carrier or go to www.flytohouston2houston.com to check the status of their carrier, and then also to check with their carriers to see if their flight has been canceled or not. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Metro, where's Metro? Did I miss Metro? Okay, solid waste. I know we're resuming garbage pickup on tomorrow. Harry?
Thank you, Mayor. I just want to remind everybody about, that's a little excitement. See, that's the first loose debris, and so that's a good lesson. And it allows me to start off the first thing that we can do to protect our neighborhoods. We've already done the notices to make sure that everyone who has trash service tomorrow, that they do not follow their customary practice of placing their containers out tonight. We know that on the east side, we're going to have these high winds, 40, 50 miles an hour. We do not want to, Congresswoman, trash our neighborhoods. We don't want to create projectiles. We do not want to spread waste around the city. And so we just remind folks, leave those containers in, put them out tomorrow morning, and we will be there to collect your garbage and recycling. If we are needed for major debris operations, we have our contractors who are on notice. We already have two of them that are here in town. The trucks are ready, depending on the amount of the debris field that is generated. And we also have our own city crews and contractor crews that have been working with us for the past few months with our pandemic increase in waste. And everything that you see before you in preparation for this storm is just like we've been doing for the COVID-19. We've all masked up the city to protect it from the hurricane, and we want to remind everyone to continue to mask up and protect themselves from the coronavirus. Thank you, Mayor.
Thanks, sir. And that's a good segue, because you can't be prepared for Hurricane Laura or any of these hurricanes this year without taking into account COVID-19. So let me give a brief status report. As of today, we're reporting 367 new positive cases. And 18 people who have died as it relates to COVID-19. So that's 367 newly positive cases and 18 more people on the list of people who have died. And because these two subjects are so interrelated, Dr. Peirce, if you can come and give us a status.
Thank you, Mayor. And as the Mayor points out, we need to all keep in mind that this weather event is occurring in the midst of a pandemic. The pandemic has not taken a break. It has not, the virus is still in our community. I want to congratulate Houstonians because we have done a great job in driving the positivity rate down quite a bit. We're down to just over 9% now, and it was at over 30% just a few weeks ago. So that is a tremendous effort and a tremendous victory. Well, it's a tremendous advancement. We're not quite there yet. Well, we would like to get it below 5%, but that is clearly within sight. And that's going to be really important to getting schools open and the economy up and going again. So do not forget about the virus and all of the precautions that we have in place. So if you are someone who is sheltering at home with your family, and it's a small number of people, and it's your family that you live with every day, you know how your house runs, and you know how you protect yourselves. Should you find yourself having to stay someplace else, whether you're staying with family, friends, in a hotel, wherever you may wind up having to relocate temporarily, all the same rules still apply. So we still need to wear the face masks, right? And we still need to keep 6 feet from each other. And we still need to avoid getting into any sort of congregate setting. So it's very important. We don't want this weather event to have undone all of the great work that we have achieved in beating this virus down to that low positivity rate. If I could switch to my emergency medical hat for a moment, I want to remind folks, those of you who live in the community that have life-sustaining equipment that is generally electrical powered at home, that because this is a wind event and we've already heard a conversation about we worry about power, that if should you lose power, you have an emergency plan in place. When you got your equipment, you were trained on it. So a couple of reminders. Number one, make sure that your batteries are all charged and keep them charged. Number two, should your power go out and your batteries are starting to get low and you're getting concerned and you decide to move, remember to keep your batteries with you, even if they are empty, even if they've burned out. Bring them with you because wherever you go, you can recharge them, which also means do not forget to bring your battery chargers. And this may sound like a silly thing for me to have to remind folks, but this is based on experience. A third thing is as you move and you go from place to place, keep all of that equipment inside something which is waterproof. And along with your medical equipment and your batteries and the chargers and all of those sorts of things you need to bring for those folks and for all pretty much anybody else who has to move, when you bring your medications, again, make sure that you keep your medications in a watertight container as well so they don't get wet when moving from one place to another, and then when you arrive there, they're not useful to you. And then the third thing, and then is I just want to remind folks, is that hospitals are not shelters. Hospitals have become very, very vigilant about containing coronavirus, and people who are not patients are not allowed in the building. So do not think that, well, if things go bad, I'll just go to the hospital down the street. The hospitals will not let you in. Hospitals will not function as shelters. So you need to have a different plan in mind as we move forward. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. And then tomorrow people may say, Mayor, this wasn't bad at all, and you all made too much of a fuss. Well, let me tell you, these storms rapidly intensify, and you have to be ready, and you have to go through the same steps, regardless of what the outcome may be. To the extent this storm remains too on the east side and we don't get a lot of wind or rain or the storm surge, for example, then consider ourselves blessed and fortunate. But there is no substitute for preparation. So you have to prepare. You have to prepare. You have to prepare for the worst, hope for the best. And then if it turns out not to be as bad as we thought it could be, then that's a good thing. That's a good thing. So better to be prepared and not need the preparation than to need it and not to be prepared. The other thing is that assuming things stay to the east, and let me just tell you, 40 miles would make a big difference. If this storm had just come 40 miles to the west, it would be very disastrous for the fourth largest city in the United States of America. Because of the rapid intensification of this storm, no, you just didn't have the ability to evacuate literally hundreds of thousands of people in the city of Houston, if not a million more. So if it had just moved 40 miles to the west, could be catastrophic, especially with the rapid intensification. And so let's be grateful, let's be thankful, and then let's continue to be continue to be prayerful for those who will get a direct impact. And in that vein, I had a conversation, for example, with Nim Kidd over the Texas Department of Emergency Management, asking, for example, about the people in Port Arthur, in the Beaumont area, in Jefferson County, in Chambers, and essentially saying, you know, please let me know. And I do know that there were some people that were not able to get out of Port Arthur, still in that area, and we stand ready to assist. We want to be good neighbors. And so, for example, we had worked with many entities to provide water and ice for Houstonians, for example, power outages, to stand ready to assist Houstonians. We'll stand ready to be of assistance to our neighbors to the east. The Beaumont, Portmont, Chambers area, it matters not as we move forward. This is the first time when I heard a report that said it was unsurvivable storm surge, which means this storm was is intense and very dangerous, with a storm surge that literally can take a lot of people's lives and destroy a lot of property. We are prepared, ready. Every storm is different, but we certainly want to be prayerful for those who are in the direct line of impact with this storm. Congresswoman, you want to make a few remarks, then we'll have questions from anyone.
Well, thank you, Mayor. I simply want to be sure to thank this city and this community of emergency managers for being prepared, and to let you know that the federal government stands ready. I want to thank the FEMA administrator who called me to indicate that they are standing ready, depending on what impact would hit this area and the entire Southeast region. In addition, it's important to note that the Coast Guard is also standing ready. I'm sure if they are here, I want to thank them. Obviously, in the midst of the storm, Mayor, if we were to be hit directly, it's important to note that Coast Guard doesn't rescue in the middle of the storm. And so it would be important for all of us to be able to evacuate. I want to add my concern for those in Port Arthur and the Jefferson County, Beaumont area. We know that as of the most recent assessment, that this storm will hit the Lake Charles area and go up in a northerly way. But the mayor, you are very right that this detour could be taken at any moment. I do want to reaffirm comments being made that we expect the wind force here in this area of 30 to 40 miles per hour. I think you've already been asked to remove anything in the outside area of your home that might become a missile of sorts, and maybe you still have the time to do that. And follow instructions about being out this evening for those who do not have to be out. 30 to 40 miles per hour wind is not anything to dismiss. We know that the surge expected in the Lake Charles area is a 9-foot surge, and as has been indicated, you can't survive that. So I am very grateful to hear the COVID numbers going down, but the one way to expand community spread is in a time of disaster, not following the instructions of a mask, washing your hands, and making sure that you have sanitizer. So Mayor, we're here as a federal government to make sure that you know that we are working to be alongside of you. We don't know what damage may come about with the 30 to 40 miles, nor do we know whether or not this will, even if it's a fast-moving storm, we don't know whether it will accelerate, create greater damage for people. My final point is to make sure that in some way you're checking on your elderly neighbors, but as well your neighbors with small children, or single parents, anyone that you know, a disabled person that may be vulnerable even in 30 to 40 miles and less rain that we've had before, and particularly if we see power outages, which I hope that we won't, Mayor, if I remind you, some pockets of the community during Hurricane Ike were out for about 6 weeks. So we know that power outages can really be damaging, and I just hope that everyone checks on their neighbors the way they can, which is to do it in a way that is safe to you. But let us be reminded of our neighbors, and the federal government is here and stands ready to be of assistance in no matter how the turn comes or the amount of wind or damage that you may face today. Thank you.
Thank you, Congresswoman. And Chief Pena reminded me we've already provided some assistance to our neighbors to the east. Chief Pena.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mayor. Yes, so to piggyback on what the Congresswoman was saying, we're looking at protection here for our community first, but we do have capacity to help our neighbors to the east who really are being impacted. At this point, we have four members that are being deployed to the Beaumont area as part of the SETRAC deployment out there. We also have personnel that are on Texas Task Force 1 that are ready to deploy as well to other parts of the state or the country if as needed. So thank you, Mayor, for allowing us to participate in those programs, because you know, at some point we have received assistance in other times ourselves, and we want to reciprocate and be able to assist others. Thank you.
Thanks, Chief. And again, I want to thank Mayor Pro Tem Marden. And I know in respect to the Kingwood area, we've already lowered Lake Houston, anticipating rain, so to provide them more room there. And thank you, Councilmember Abby Kamen, who's the chairperson of Public Safety and Homeland Security. So thank you. We'll take whatever questions you have. Well, one of the things we're assessing is to see what track this storm continues to be on, whether or not it bobbles a little bit to the west, because that certainly will have an impact on our area. It will have an impact, for example, on the velocity of the wind. And right now, we're anticipated the wind could be anywhere from, really it's from 30 to 60 miles per hour. In some cases, it could be 70. So that certainly will have an impact on power outages and the degree of power outages in our area. Rainfall would be something else, but it's the wind pretty much concerned about. The storm surge is always important if there's a shift. And, you know, there's some indication the storm surge, for example, in the areas that's going to take a direct hit, could be 30 miles in. That is highly significant. Can you imagine that being in the Galveston Bay and the storm surge being 30 miles in? And I'm glad you asked that question because it points out the need for the ICDITE or the coastal spine. If we needed any proof, any evidence that there's a need for funding, Congresswoman, I hate to keep, you know, but you're here. That coastal spine is desperately needed. And let me tell you why. When you have storms that rapidly intensify, and you don't have the time to move people out the area, you need that coastal spine. You know, 45% of what's produced petroleum for this country comes out of that Port Arthur area. Okay. So you're talking about refineries, you're talking about petroleum production, diesel fuel, businesses, homeowners, property owners. If that storm was, let's say, 40 miles to the west, hitting the Galveston Bay with a storm surge that could be 30 miles in, it would be catastrophic for this area. And you have to have the coastal spine, quite frankly, and we need it yesterday. We are just very fortunate. But let me tell you, we are running out of we're running out of lies, so to speak. Hurricane Ike was an initial warning in 2008. You don't have it. And now you had two storms, hurricanes going into the Gulf. One fizzle, and Hurricane Laura is really coming as close as you can get. I don't know how many more chances we're going to have for the Houston area. And that impacts not just the Houston region and the state of Texas, but that impacts us nationally with global ramifications. Okay.
Well, the mayor called the federal government's name. Let me just indicate to him that I'm an enthusiastic supporter of the coastal spine. It is long overdue, and as I acknowledge Chairwoman Kamen and Vice Mayor Pro Tem Marden for their leadership. Combined with that needing of the coastal spine, of course, is the immediacy of trying to get through what the mayor has repeatedly suggested, and we just were on a conference call today of trying to get a compromise, and that is, of course, the county and city funding, federal funding that now may be an enhanced need, the unemployment dollars, the cash disbursement, and passing the HEROES Act for the essential workers that are standing here today. So our answer to you is yes, and I think the other point is, I want to thank the National Weather Service. I might have mentioned them earlier, but they have all said to all of you as leaders is that this is going to be an active hurricane season. We are not finished until November, and they can't give you the names. They said they're prepared to go into Roman numerals if we have so many hurricanes that we run out of alphabet. I hope that is not the case, but the fact that the city is prepared as it is and giving all of you an opportunity to see what you should do, it's very, 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 very very important that you follow the instructions now, because there is the indication that this will not be the last hurricane that we will see in this region, and certainly will not be the last one that may be extremely difficult and devastating. And I hope not, but it is an active hurricane season.
Any other questions? Before I end, I do want to say this, because Mayor Pro Tem Martin, your district, you affected in the Kingwood area with respect to San Jacinto and Lake Houston, and with Clear Lake, because three of the precincts that we call for voluntary evacuation was in the Clear Lake area, and I know you've done some work on the coastal spine. You want to speak to it?
Yes, sir. The most southern part of the city of Houston is the Clear Lake area in the South Belt Ellington area. We did voluntary evacuation of those areas in anticipation of this event. As you've heard repeatedly, we anticipate this because we're on the clean side of it, which is the west side, more of a wind event than a rain event. Because of that, you're going to see down trees, trees that may fall on electric lines. Please make sure you contact 311 and report those, and we'll get Houston Fire and Houston Public Works on the scene ASAP. But by all means, do not do anything with down wires, especially as a storm surge approaches in Galveston Bay. That could be a very dangerous situation. So for everybody out there, God bless, be safe, and let's make sure we get this thing together. So thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. Councilmember Kamen, both thoughts.
I'll be very brief, because we all need to practice what we're preaching and get off the road soon and shelter in place. This isn't lost on anyone that this falls on the anniversary of Harvey. And I want to reiterate, as the mayor has done, that this is not Harvey. It's Laura. It has its own style, but it's always important to remain vigilant. I really want to just thank, and I'm profoundly appreciative of all of our first responders, our police officers, our fire, OEM, our departments, public works and solid waste. Everyone has come together, Mayor, under your leadership, and the caliber of professionalism that I have seen makes me so proud to be a Houstonian. And I also want to thank all of our residents who have remained vigilant and will continue through the night. I know we're all excited to have trash pick up again tomorrow, but please, please secure your bins tonight. Make sure there's any loose debris out. We will continue to remain resilient, and we're always Houston strong. Thank you.
Any more questions? All right, well, we're going to continue to be around here for a while to monitor the situation, and OEM will continue to be activated until this storm has cleared our area. So please be safe. Be off the road by 8 p.m., okay? Social distance. Keep your masks on. Thank you very much.
I want to thank you so much for being so involved in the community.